Steve Schmidt made national headlines this week when he announced he was quitting the Republican Party. The GOP strategist and now MSNBC analyst who ran John McCain's presidential campaign and notoriously lobbied for Alaska Governor Sarah Palin to be the VP nominee tweeted, 29 years and 9 months ago, I registered to vote and became a member of the Republican Party, which was founded in 1854 to oppose slavery and stand for the dignity of human life. Today, I renounce my membership in the Republican Party. It is fully the party of Trump. Schmidt likened the separation of immigrant children and parents to, quote, the same evil that separated families during slavery and dislocated tribes and broke up Native American families. He quoted Ronald Reagan's tombstone that, quote, there is purpose and worth to each and every life, and wrote that Reagan would be, quote, ashamed of McConnell and Ryan and all the rest. And he concluded, this independent voter will be aligned with the only party left in America which stands for what is right and decent and remains fidelitous to our republic, objective truth, the rule of law, and our allies. That party is the Democratic Party. In later interviews, he also cited Trump's recent friendliness with Kim Jong-un while criticizing allies like Canada. Schmidt was following in the footsteps of other prominent GOP media figures who have fled the party in the past few years, including Joe Scarborough, Mary Madeline, George Will. Will just wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post that went so far as to advocate voting against the GOP this fall to, quote, quarantine Trump. Yours truly was ahead of the curve, switching back in 2010. I switched from R to I, and I published this essay in the Huffington Post explaining under the headline, for me, the party is over. I wrote then, the national GOP is a party of exclusion and litmus tests, dominated on social issues by the religious right, with zero discernible outreach by the national party to anyone who doesn't fit neatly within its parameters. Instead, the GOP has extended itself to its fringe while throwing under the bus long-standing members. I similarly explained why I was not comfortable joining the Democratic Party. So Schmidt now joins the 45% of us who don't ID as R's or D's. And I say it's time that our voices are represented in closed primary states, on debate stages, and in the media. Joining me now is Kansas gubernatorial candidate Greg Orman. You'll remember he left the Republican Party to become an independent, ran a very close race for the United States Senate in 2014, ultimately lost to Pat Robertson. Pat Roberts, I always say that, Pat Roberts. You didn't lose to the evangelical leader, Greg. I always stumble on that. But you're back. React to the news of Steve Schmidt.
Well, you know, I think we've seen a lot of these high-profile defections from the Republican Party. But frankly, they're lagging indicators, not leading indicators. As you mentioned, you left the party in 2010. The fact is, Americans have been leaving both parties in droves really since 1998. And they're doing it for a range of reasons, but most notably because this system of government just isn't working for them. You know, the average American household hasn't seen a pay increase since 1999. Think about that. The amount of time that it takes a child to go from being born to graduating from high school, that's how long it's been since the average American has seen household income go up. And so obviously they're dissatisfied with both parties and they're reacting with their feet.
So there are some who will look at you, who will study your record, and they'll say, you know, Greg Orman is a smart guy, Princeton educated, successful businessman, entrepreneur, but I don't want to waste my vote for him. I had an exchange on this very issue last night with Bill Maher. Roll the tape and then let Greg reply.
In this country, we really only have the two choices.
We've right.
tried many times to change it, and if we were a parliamentary democracy, it would be different.
Mm-hmm.
But third parties just wind up making the better party lose too many times. So I have
radio listeners who hold me singly accountable for the election of Donald Trump because I admitted on the air that I didn't vote for him and I didn't vote for her either. I voted for the Libertarian ticket and I'm still proud of that vote. And I say, take it up with the 102 million who were eligible and didn't go out and exercise the franchise. You get this criticism. What's your response to those who say, you're a smart guy, Greg, you'd be a great public servant, but I don't want to waste my vote?
Well, you know, I think if you look at what's happening in the country today, and we certainly see this as we travel throughout Kansas, voters desperately want something different. They want leaders who are going to tell the truth, who are going to serve them and not special interests and party bosses. And invariably what's happened is both parties have done a lot of work, and it's the one thing they agree on in keeping out competition. And so we're working not only to get people elected, but also to break down those barriers that both parties use to deprive voters of legitimate choices. And you and I have had the opportunity to talk about some of the things that we're working on, but we're trying to break down those barriers. But the biggest barrier is psychological. You know, 44% of Americans are politically independent. If they just got behind independent candidates would start winning. We'd create a third force in our politics, and we'd be in a much better position to hold both parties accountable to meet the needs of the American people.
If we could just establish a beachhead in the Senate, it would only take three or four eyes to be elected. And then they would have to play ball with you to get anything done. All of a sudden, an independent caucus could hold the cards. Am I naive in thinking that?
No, and in fact, that's exactly what we were trying to accomplish in Kansas in 2014. I was deeply concerned that because we weren't solving problems as a nation, that our standard of living, our status in the world, and the very existence of the middle class in America was at risk. But if we could get that fulcrum, if we could get a few people elected to the U.S. Senate who could mediate between Democrats and Republicans and ultimately determine who the majority leader is and who holds those gavels, we could get the Senate back focused on a problem-solving agenda. You know, we're also looking at the same thing in Kansas with our governor's race. You know, William Allen White, the famed Emporia Gazette editor, once said, when anything's going to happen in America, it's going to happen first in Kansas. And so we're looking to make that happen.
Let me just say in closing, we may not be a majority, but we, the eyes, we are a plurality. Here's where we're deficient. And I don't mean Orman and Smirkanish, but the passion exists on the fringes. And that's why, you know, we've seeded the debate, because they are the loudest voices. And that's what has to change. All the people watching us who say, yeah, I don't feel comfortable as an R or as a D, need to get off the sofa and into the game. Anyway, good luck and thank you for being back.
Thanks for having me.
I want to remind you to answer the survey question at smirkanish.com. It is a provocative one. I cannot wait to see how this is going to turn out in just about 25 minutes time. If the drug trade is partly to blame for the migration crisis from Central America, should drugs be decriminalized? Still to come, lately, more and more political celebrities have been going low instead of high.